Hi guys, a very warm welcome to the Niels van Rooy Design channel and a warm welcome to the newest iteration of the Countach, the brand new coach build, if you like, one of I think 112 cars to be built, all already sold, based on the Aventador. Let's dive into the video and afterwards we're gonna get into Photoshop and see how we could improve this brand new $2 million car.
Listen, what do you hear? The roar of an engine? Or the outrageous scream of someone breaking the rules? Are these scissor doors? Or a definitive break with the past? And what about this? A headlamp showing the way? Or an invitation to open your eyes and be bold? And this is a line drawn by pencil, right? No, it's more than that. It's what we call the Countach line. And it marked the end of the sports car to become the first supercar. And now, what do you see? Just a picture on a calendar? A poster on 100, 1,000, 1,000,000 walls? Oh, believe me, it's far more than that. It's our collective imagination, the most inaccessible place in the world. Here, only true icons have the power to enter and to change who we are, forever. Today, 50 years since its first unforgettable unveil, we turn back to look at it again. And what we see is our future. New Lamborghini Countach. Future is our legacy.
So that's a very bold video speaking about two things basically. One, the collective memory, collective conscience about what a Lambo is, what a Countach is, and then about taking that into the future, that their heritage is their future. So let's have a look at this sort of facelift, let's say, of the original car. The original car that featured in the video as well had a different type of wheel. So this wheel arguably is more iconic. And then this body kit, let's say, fender flares, spoiler, is part of that facelift. And then there was a third facelift, the 25th anniversary car. I would say that's quite horrendous, actually. It got a lot of extra body cladding, a lot of extra Tupperware with these horizontal lines inspired quite clearly by the Testarossa at the time, which was, again, also a groundbreaking piece of design. But nevertheless, I would say let's focus on this car because this is a very important piece of design. And that's not just because of that Lambo line or Countach line that they mentioned, which starts here at the front of the car and basically flows over the roof all the way towards the back. It's sort of one continuous flow, especially if you look at the cars that followed, the Diablo and Murcielago. But it's also the graphics. So the graphics are like these iconic Marcello Gandini-shaped wheel wells, if you like, but also this lovely window there and these sharp, pointy angles. And then, of course, here this Naka duck, this air intake contrasted with black paint inside. So this was very popular in the 70s and the 80s, came directly from aviation because this is the most efficient way of taking in air into a body, so feeding that into an engine, without creating turbulence or a mess around the car through air. Important elements to take forward into the next generation. And let's see if they were successful with that. And of course, this is my perhaps not so humble opinion, but nevertheless, it's my take on this unique car. What we see here is that early prototype car, which doesn't feature the Naka duck, and it does feature these lines, these intakes, which both weren't sufficient. So in the end, Lambo had to put on that big box, that iconic air intake here, and then put in that Naka duct just to feed that massive V12 here in the back. Then why, I'm asking, why did they put that not so, let's say, in our collective consciousness implanted slatted intake into the modern car? Because nobody really remembers this, apart from perhaps some car design and Lamborghini geeks. Why didn't they pronounce that boxy intake a lot more? Why is this not a Naka duct? Why is that this sort of sharp and pointy element? We'll come to that a little bit later. Let's first have a look at the front. I won't mention any names, but there is somebody reviewing cars online who said, well, why are the headlights in that sort of more pushed back position, back as in, why isn't the nose flat and then the headlights equally flat to that nose? Well, that's because we're not living in 1970 anymore, and a modern car is a sculpture, even a modern take on a classical, very radical and flat, razor sharp car from the 70s and 80s. So rightfully so, they pushed in the corners, reduced visual bulk here, and made it a more sculptural, modern piece of design. You can also see they implemented this graphic that I just mentioned of this iconic windscreen, and it's actually literally just a graphic. So this is the actual windscreen, and this is a carbon fiber insert on the front end of the car that makes you think that that is actually part of the windscreen. So cleverly done, because again, this is in a way a coach-built car, so they have to work with everything that's underneath. They cannot change anything bone-wise. They're plastic surgeons, just like I'm a plastic surgeon at Niels Verhoey Design. I don't change the structure of the car, the crash beams, the rollover protection. No, I change the meat, I change the skin. And that's what they've done here as well. So then people go on and say, well, why isn't this headlight positioned more towards the bottom, so somewhere there? Well, again, because it's not a possibility. There is something called law and legislation, and they prevent you from putting lights at the bottom end of the car if they are your main beam lights. You can put some corner lights and some daytime running lights a little bit lower, but you can't put lamps completely at the bottom of the car, because it's just not allowed anymore. Then some people say, well, why didn't they put in these typical pop-up headlights? Again, they shouldn't have done that. So I disagree with that statement. I think they've done it well in the way they've done it here. It's not allowed anymore. So pop-up headlights are extremely dangerous. If you hit a pedestrian, you know, this sharp, pointy, folded bit, it's super hard. So you're gonna completely kill a pedestrian. That's one. Two, they're horrendous when it comes to aerodynamics. I'm sure you get the point of if you put your hand out of the car on the highway and that versus that makes a massive difference in how your hand is pushing through the air. So they're horrendous when it comes to aerodynamics. So that's two. Number three, this is a modern take. This is not a retrospective take. Yes, we're looking back, but we're pushing that all into the future. So they shouldn't have done it. Even if they were allowed, I think they shouldn't have done it in the first place. So yes, well done to deny, let's say, people the one-to-one copy of the original. This is a fresh modern take, a clean modern take of the front end. And let's have a look at that base car, the Aventador, and see how many surface changes it has from the side going into the fender and then going into the bonnet and then the bonnet and again the bonnet. So this is not, I'm not saying this is good or bad for that matter. I'm just showing you they are there, all these surface changes. This is a wildly complex car. Look at how many surface changes and different types of material we have here. We've got exposed carbon fiber, we've got matte black, we've got gloss black, we've got red inserts, we've got an intake with an intake inside. Very complex. A modern piece of car design, I would say this last iteration of the Aventador that I'm showing here, more or less by accident, isn't at all the best Aventador. I would say the earliest car actually is the best, and these are just add-ons. But in general, I would say excellent piece of design, beautiful sculpture, lovely proportions, great surfacing ideas, a very modern take on the iconic Lamborghini shape. So having said that, let's move towards the new car, and here again you can see these inserts a little bit better and how they truly make your eye think that it's part of the windscreen graphic. So well done. Here, this is obviously a little nod towards these pop-up headlights that used to be there, you could argue, in the car from the 70s and the 80s. That I find not that well executed. I would say even if there would be only the tiniest little opening to let some air escape, to let's whatever, there would actually be a reason to have that shape here, this lovely facet in the fender. And now it's just there to remind you of the Countach, which had pop-up headlights, which you cannot do anymore, but it doesn't have any other function apart from obviously breaking up the sheer cleanliness and size of the top end of that fender above the headlight. In general, apart from that, I think it's a very nice iteration of the original recipe. It's a very sheer, so very clean, one side to one side, but still very sculpted, three-dimensional iteration view on that classic recipe. With here in the front, obviously, that iconic intake that only the very early cars had. So they did some shopping around, let's say, from early cars, later cars. The intake here, obviously, comes from, let's say, the facelift car. Nicely done, I would say. It's quite a cohesive, consistent, clean piece of design, very simple and pure. However, then we're moving towards the side and we see this massive air intake, which I understand is there because obviously the massive V12 in the back that needs air. However, I think this looks incredibly weak. I mean, you don't ever see that kind of sharp and pointy volumes and surfaces in modern cars because they look weak. This size and shape of intake is understandably a carryover part, if you like, not literally, but what is behind that, the engineering behind it, the amount of air that needs to come into that car to feed the V12, there is a certain amount and it has to come in, otherwise the engine will overheat. So that graphic and the size of it, I understand. But that pointiness here, I don't. And I would have loved to see a modern interpretation of that Nakada applied to the side of that car. Some people have photoshopped the old-fashioned sort of teledial wheels of the second-gen or facelifted Countach in here, and they say, "Oh, it's so much better. The tire needs more sidewall, and then we have these simple rounded wheels." I completely disagree with that. That doesn't work on a modern car. It's like putting the face of a granny on the body of a 20-year-old, or the other way around. The two don't work together. However, I think this wheel perhaps is a little bit too complex, too multifaceted, literally and figuratively speaking. Yes, there are these lovely, completely rounded holes, but they are surrounded by little tiny holes and surface changes. And yes, I think it's interesting they did a lot more with the wheel than just putting in these big holes. Again, I don't think that would work. However, this perhaps is a little bit too much and a little bit too complex for consistency even. So just looking at the surfaces and the treatment of that nose that we just discussed, and how lovely that has been executed, and then looking at that side view, which is a lot more complex and a lot more is going on. Yes, it has a super tiny little intake hint there, but not the big box that I think would have been a lot more relevant than these over there. And then we have this just shape on the bottom, which I'm quite, you know, I don't understand it. There's nothing that it does. It's not an intake here or there. So there's no air coming in or out. It's just literally shape, added stuff to a car that actually should be super clean and minimalistic, because that's the recipe of the original Countach. Here again, a nice frontal view showing that clean front end, clean, let's say, front fender, and the whole setup, the whole architecture of the front with very clean and minimal shapes. And then here suddenly we have this sort of added stuff, added lines, and then this very sharp and pointy intake, which I said, you know, yes, I understand this part of it, but a new, fresh interpretation of the Naka intake would have been really, I think, more appropriate. Then here, from this perspective, we can see there is this box, but maybe for aerodynamic reasons, I don't know, maybe that's the reason they couldn't have done it, but I think it would have been awesome to see this bold version, modern take on this block on the rear of the car that is that intake. And again, looking at the base, so the architecture that's underneath, very complex surfacing, multifaceted, like I said, there's a lot going on, most of it pretty good, but they truly cleaned it up in this car. However, it could have been a lot more clean, and that's truly moving towards the side, and then especially moving towards the back, which is based on this Aventador. And this is obviously one of the very last iterations of the Aventador, which has already been in production for almost 10 years, I think. But the base of it, so the original Aventador especially, is so clean, is so well executed, such a lovely modern interpretation of that iconic Lamborghini shape. And I'm not somebody who is all for less is more. So I, again, the reason why I think this is an excellent piece of design is because, for instance, the way the shut lines are integrated into this body, I mean, it's magnificent work, truly magnificent work. They are just this amazing sculpture of facets and shut lines and surfacing that just works, and it's very well executed, and especially if we switch to the rear end of the new Countach, you can see it's been very much cleaned up. So yes, great. And we have that little bit of a box here, but yeah, it sort of fades out towards the back. And I would have loved to see it a bit more pronounced and a little bit more pure. But the biggest issue I would say I have with the rear end are these tail lights, which are obviously taken, copied, carried over from the Sian Lambo, which is a very wild piece of design. I'm not a fan, but that's a very different story. The problem is that everybody will recognize them. Everybody who is a car girl or a guy will recognize these from that car. And they're so iconic that, you know, there's not a problem with carryover parts. It's a trick that, that any coach builder applies, that many manufacturers apply. For instance, the tail lights of the XJ220 came from a Rover. The tail lights from many TVRs came from the Ford Fiesta at the time. The tail lights of the DB7 Aston Martin, Mazda. So no problem, right? Even Lambo did this when Volkswagen took over. And they facelifted the Diablo at the time, which they did a marvelous job at. That is the type of recipe I would say should have been applied to this car as well. That was so modern, so clean. The only minimum changes, they took away the pop-up headlights and inserted, believe it or not, Nissan headlights. And the Nissan logo in the glass was actually covered by a tiny piece of carbon fiber. But they were so well integrated into the sculpture of the Diablo, nobody cared. And it was a fantastic car. And the rear end, believe it or not, the tail lights came from a Bova, a bus, a coach. Of all things, right? Carryover parts as cheap as possible. But they look absolutely magnificent in that sculpture. So it shows you that it's not the cost of developing a light that a low volume car like this car with only 100 plus being made, if that doesn't line up, of course, it's totally understandable. But then still, there could have been fantastic carryover parts applied smartly to this car that wouldn't be so recognizable. I think that is the issue I have with the rear end. And that basically concludes the video on what still is a very interesting piece of car design. Thank you for tuning into this video. Let me know in the comments if you agree or disagree with my analysis, with what you think of this Lambo. And I'll see you very, very soon again. Cheers.